Great, yeah, so CPT has been around for over 20 years at this point. We're based in DC, and we're founded really on this idea that it was the mid-90s, and it was very clear that Congress and the regulatory agencies were going to be making law about the internet, whether they really understood how it worked or not. And so it's really important to have people involved in policymaking in DC that both deeply understood the technology, but also had a deep commitment to civil liberties and ensuring that the internet and connected technologies could develop and continue to grow and have a legal system that really supported innovation while also promoting fundamental rights to free expression and privacy as lawmakers, governors, policymakers were looking at what does this startling new technology really mean for our culture. So we do a lot of different kinds of work at CDT. We file amicus briefs, we participate in regulatory proceedings, may have been following the net neutrality work that's been happening over the past couple of years. Big fight, yeah. Can we even have net neutrality regulations at all, reclassifying internet access as a telecommunication service. The past couple of months, there's been a lot of focus on what does it mean to have privacy regulations for internet service providers in terms of their access to data of their customers as they're browsing the web and using the internet. So there's kind of no end to the work that the regulatory agencies are doing. We get involved in legislation, whether it's on the side of advocating for reforms to surveillance law, or in my area of especially like U.S. First Amendment law, it's typically a more defensive approach, trying to help Congress understand that what they're considering may violate the First Amendment, be inconsistent with First Amendment values. We also do a lot of work around the law section 230, which you may be familiar with. It's part of the Communications Act that ensures that hosts of third-party content and others who transmit and facilitate access to third-party content can't be held legally liable for that. So if I tweet something defamatory about Catherine can sue me, but she can't sue Twitter, and that's basically the only way that Twitter can exist, because if they were on the hook for potentially every defamatory thing that somebody put on their platform, they would be sued into oblivion in a matter of seconds. So a lot of our work focus in the Free Expression Project focuses on protecting and promoting that the legal framework, the combination of First Amendment law, Section 230, net neutrality, and the ability to use encryption that we see as kind of the framework that helps support individuals' right to access information and express themselves.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Does that also apply if I'm, let's say you're Twitter and I'm doing something illegal with Twitter, through Twitter, is Twitter liable for that criminal activity?
It's state criminal law, no, for sure, because 230 preempts inconsistent state law. So basically, the way 230 works is it protects the operator from being found liable if they incur kind of publisher liability. So if what the intermediary does is something that kind of in the realm of traditional publisher activity, which is distributing information, editing information, kind of reviewing information, if your liability kind of hinges back to that, then the 230 shields the operator. If the CEO of Twitter was engaged in a criminal conspiracy with you, and was actively working with you to forward some kind of to commit some sort of crime, then he's not sort of perpetually immune from all possible wrongdoing. But if the claim kind of boils down to what the intermediary did was offer a general purpose service that someone has now used to commit an illegal act, then by and large they're we were engaged in an unsuccessful legislative battle lobbying effort against an amendment to federal criminal anti-trafficking law about a year and a half. So 230 has exemptions for inconsistent state law and civil liability, but it has no effect on federal criminal law. And something we've seen over the past couple of years is a move by people who want to see intermediaries liable in some way, saying, it's like, okay, they can't get, there was some failed attempts to get 230 amended itself directly. So now we're seeing a focus on, can you craft a new federal criminal liability that makes use of existing exemption in 230 and somehow create a new federal crime that involves intermediaries posting for free speech? So there's a very kind of small but difficult to parse edit to the federal anti-trafficking statute that now creates potential liability if you knowingly financially benefit from advertisements that you recklessly disregard are involved in a trafficking concern. And so this is, we know that this edit to this law was aimed at the website backpage.com, that their advocates were looking for and prosecutors were looking for ways to hold that website liable for the fact that people post trafficking ads on the service. But many, part of why there's a strategy to go create a federal criminal law covering this is that in every court that's looked at it, almost every court that's looked at it has found that 230 shields backpage from civil liability for their posting of ads, even though some of those ads are related to trafficking.
What do you think of the Kamala Harris's prosecution of backpage?
So that was really interesting. See, there's, I was saying to a student in this morning's class, it's like, it's really hard to keep track of all of the backpage litigation because there's so many different proceedings going on. So, right, at the same time that the Supreme Court was basically denying Backpage's opposition to the Senate subpoena of their CEO, Harris in California and Texas AG both brought state claims against the CEO of Backpage. But then you read the complaints and nothing that they don't allege anything, as far as I can tell, they don't allege anything that actually points to criminal conduct. There's this really interesting part in one of the complaints that might be Texas, where the prosecutor describes like the sting operation that he set up. He posted an ad for couch and an ad for sex in the adult services section using the same phone number, just, you know, see what happens. Like, immediately the ad in the adult services section gets, you know, multiple kind of contacts and multiple contacts throughout the days that it was up. And he only ever got one person contacting him about the couch. Okay. Different markets, right? But like that alone is not, you know, the implication is this is really a website set up for helping people, you know, engage in prostitution, not really to engage in selling couches. But that doesn't actually, his one example doesn't actually prove that, right? Then it goes through the whole sort of the phone call that he has with the Backpage CEO. To report, as now as law enforcement, to report that there's a trafficking ad. And he's told, like, okay, well, here's our formal report of use hotline. And the CEO, you know, kind of walks him through, like, we want to have some confirmation that you actually are law enforcement because sometimes we get fraudulent reports of people trying to get ads taken down saying they're law enforcement, but they actually aren't, which is a good, you know, safeguard to have in place here in the confirmation process. So people can abuse the system. And then the prosecutor is like, you know, I could hear him typing as we were talking, and it was clear he was looking up the ad. And then the prosecutor is like, within, you know, by the end of the day, both the trafficking ad and the ad for the couch had come down because they used the same phone number. So they're sort of linked by both obviously coming from the same person. And sort of puts this example there as though it's a smoking gun of some sort. But all it shows is that, like, when the CEO obtained direct knowledge that there was a potentially unlawful ad, not only took down that ad, but also the other things that that person had been posting on the site. So I don't see how this claim goes forward. I mean, it didn't seem to me to allege anything close to enough to actually demonstrate that there was knowing contribution to a criminal enterprise here. But I think we're going to see that case go forward and the Senate case go forward at the same time. So who knows how it's all going to turn out.
Is there some related complications in the Craigslist case? Craigslist, I think, one of their sections is being used almost exclusively for.
Right. So in 2007, 2008, there was this big campaign from state attorneys general focused first on Craigslist.com about their adult services section. And Section 230 protected the website from any kind of actual liability. But after a while, Craigslist decided that the pressure from all of these law enforcement, or the top law enforcement officials across states, that this pressure was too much, and they removed the adult services section. For a little while, they had censored kind of put up over the section. And as a result, there are still ads for prostitution on Craigslist, and then a lot of the traffic also moved over to Backpage, and so AGs shifted their focus to Backpage. And it's this kind of, the Craigslist example is a good one because it shows how merely removing the label for a site or for a particular section of the site hasn't changed the fact that some people will use the ability to upload content to upload ads for services. Then that all turned into, so the focus shifted over to Backpage, and there was like years-long campaign targeting Backpage. A number of different court cases, the sheriff for Cook County, Illinois, brought a suit against Backpage in his district and lost that case. So then this past summer, his next step was to, after like multiple failed attempts to go after Backpage directly, he sent threatening letters to Visa and MasterCard, who were the two credit cards processing payments for Backpage. And again, the payments that they're processing are, costs $10 to post an ad in the adult services section. They charge for posting in the adult services section because of pressure they got from the AGs years ago saying, charge people to put ads in the section so that we've got a paper trail to investigate if you think one of these ads is illegal. Like, it used to be just like post for free and they make money by putting ads kind of around the ads. But under extreme pressure from law enforcement, they started asking people like, give us a name and a contact number and credit card information so that there's the beginnings of a paper trail to turn your information over to law enforcement so they can investigate. So the only reason that you're just charging these ads in the first place is what the law enforcement wanted, but now it's this like horrible thing that they're making money off of these ads. So DART threatens the two credit card companies, like sends them a letter on official sheriff stationery and talks about, like throws around some federal banking regulations, statutes that apply to the credit cards and wouldn't actually result in penalties, but is sort of implying that they risk some sort of federal prosecution if they continue doing business with Backpage. And also, after sending the letter, like gets on the phone to the different credit card companies, calling up vice presidents and CEOs of these companies, saying it was Visa who was the little bit of a holdout. This came up in discovery later in the case that it's like the night before DART is planning to hold a press conference, he calls up Visa CEO and saying, like, we're gonna have this press conference. If you haven't terminated your relationship with Backpage by then, we will be talking about how Visa is supporting the trafficking of children, right? And so, bogus legal threats, but also total, like, reputational threats. Backpage challenges this in court and ends up winning in a really entertaining Seventh Circuit thing written by Judge Brewster. If you read one court opinion this year, read that one, because it's just, he goes through all of the, like, how and why we have in the First Amendment law against government coercion, even of intermediaries who are not the speakers themselves, but the people who are essential to speech getting from the speaker to the audience. We have protection for that under the First Amendment. Government can't just go and coerce the weakest link in the chain and use that as a way to, the ultimate aim of the government official censorship of speech, then the First Amendment does provide protection against government coercion aimed censoring that speech. So that was a great legal victory for Backpage. Visa and MasterCard still have not restored service to them, so they still, it sort of, they won as a matter of law, and practically, it didn't have the, you know, it didn't have the impact they were looking for. But that's the kind of, that was the sort of pinnacle of the pressure. Well, then I guess the Senate subpoenas were pretty good pressure from government as well on the company. But it's just, it's been really interesting to watch this all develop over the years, from Craigslist to Backpage, and just, you know, we really are testing out, it seems, every angle of law around how the government possibly try to censor websites that they disagree with, kind of what the website is offering.
So government officials are generally shielded from being sued or lawsuits associated with their job. So the Cook County, whoever that was doing the work, can't be sued directly.
Well, so Backpage is suing them.
But the county, not him.
Well, no, suing Sheriff Dart for, I'm pretty sure it's Dart directly, on a, this I probably don't know as well, but a Section 1983 claim, because you can, there is a provision for suing a government official for the violation of human rights or of civil liberties that they kind of were directly responsible for. It's not easy to get that claim, and I'm not sure where that case is now, but it's certainly, but yeah, in general, there's the sense that there's a lot of protection for qualified immunity of government officials and the jobs.
Right, because currently there's not a deterrent from every sheriff in the country writing a letter to whoever to try to interfere with the business of Backpage.
Right, right. I mean, I guess the deterrent is that as a, you know, a court will find them to have violated the Constitution, and you'd hope that would be, you'd hope that would be a deterrent, but a financial deterrent.
But you might get elected anyway.
Yeah, right. And I mean, and that's the thing, right? Like, you want to show off that you're a crime kind of law enforcement official. You might have every, and especially if we have a political environment where flouting the Constitution doesn't actually seem to be a negative for public officials, then yeah, the incentives get really, really scary.
I have kind of a different question. Last night during your talk, I was really interested to hear about France and other European countries and the right to forget, mm-hmm. and how they seem to be kind of ramping up their energy in that area. I was hoping you could talk a little bit about that today.
Oh, sure, yeah. So are folks familiar with kind of the right to be forgotten? Kind of, there's been a big discussion going on in Europe over a number of years. And, you know, let me get your thoughts on all of this too. But kind of looking at this, you know, the challenging dynamic that we all face of, wow, information about our past is so much more kind of permanently accessible in a way that it wasn't, you know, 50 years ago. If you wrote notes to friends or loved ones or something that were in a box under your bed, chances that anybody else would ever see them were pretty low. Now if it's, you know, material that's posted to a Facebook page that then you change the privacy settings on and don't quite realize it, and it becomes public and gets indexed, and now it's forever associated with your name in Google searches, it feels like a very different kind of, there's a very different lifetime of that information kind of potentially associated with you. But what the particular case in France has to do with the Mario Castejo Gonzalez case, where man successfully sued in Spanish court and then at the European level, the Court of Justice of the European Union, to establish that under European data protection law, people have the right to demand that a search engine delist certain search results for queries that are based on their name. And so this is, in Castejo's case, there was an article that had been published in the newspaper. It was required to be published in the newspaper under Spanish law about a default on a mortgage, I think. And so this was published in the paper 17 years ago. Somewhere along the line, the paper puts their archives online. And so this information digitized, associated with his name, shows up in queries when people search Mario Cozzarino de Salas. Now if you search his name, all of the stuff about the court case comes up. So he's never gotten away from that bit of information. But his point was that this was, you know, this should not be the defining moment of his life, but it was sort of the leading search result for people looking him up on Google. So he wanted Google to stop linking to that page. And the Court of Justice agreed that European, the Data Protection Directive gives individuals a right to tell an entity that is processing personal data about them to no longer process that data if it is irrelevant, inaccurate, or excessive. This is a very broad term that could possibly mean quite a lot of things, but that's sort of the determination of the court. It was a confusing or kind of a contentious legal decision in a number of cases. They were looking at, one of the questions was, you know, should Google as a search engine be considered a processor of personal data? You know, if you imagine your one-to-one relationship with Gmail, even, right? There you are creating an account with them, you are using their service, you are providing directly to Gmail a lot of information. Understanding them to be a processor of your personal data makes a kind of intuitive sense. The idea that a search engine who is indexing information that is publicly available on the web has that same kind of relationship and responsibility to all of the people whose personal information might get swept up in that indexing was a key kind of decision in this case, and was one that was surprising to those of us who aren't European data protection experts. That seems like a much broader kind of remit for this bill than was originally intended. And so the result has been that Google has had to develop a procedure that enables people in Europe to contact them and say, live in this European country, here's some identification to back that up, here are specific URLs that contain information, my personal information that I think is not relevant to people wanting to learn about me, and have Google no longer show those URLs when people search based on their name. To me, like my big frustration with this court opinion is that it established what I think is a good determination. I mean, that the publication of the underlying information in this case was not unlawful. It was, the newspaper did not violate the law by putting the archives online. And that's good. I would want the court to decide that way. Like, newspapers should be able to take paper copies, put them online, and not have that somehow break the law. But what the court then decided is that even though the information was lawfully published, it could still be unlawful for somebody to link to that information. It could be, you know, Google could, or any search engine could see, oh, this information lawfully published, public web, true, not defamatory, you know, there's no problem with the underlying information, and then the only place where illegality creeps in is the fact that Google decides to index it and provide it as a search result. That's really different from how we've thought about linking to information on the public web before. You know, other cases about, is it lawful to link to this information, have at least asserted that the underlying material is illegal, right? Like, this is copyright infringing page, so you also shouldn't be able to link to the copyright. Or this is a defamatory post, so returning a link to it is also continuing what is unlawful there. Setting aside whether any of those cases the underlying information should be considered unlawful, just the idea that only linking to information that we acknowledge people have a right to access could still break the law is really hard to wrap my head around. So long answer to Catherine, to your question, what France is doing is basically saying that the process that Google came up with, where they will delist search results for searches by people in Europe for Europeans who modified their search results, Google was saying we will apply that to our EU domains, so like .fr, .co.uk, .es for Spain, and trying to kind of keep the effect of this law located in Europe, where it's the law. And the French government is now claiming that that is ineffective. That's an ineffective remedy because people in Europe could. At first, their argument was, you know, people in Europe. Yes, sure, 98% of people in Europe use a European version of Google, and they don't use .com. But some of them do use .com. They can circumvent this kind of geolocation of the effect by using a different version of the search engine. So Google responded by saying, fine, we will look across all of our search engines if we ever think the search is coming from within Europe, whether they're searching .com or anywhere else, we will apply these delistings. So trying to go instead from, you know, our service is just in Europe to, okay, fine, we think the people are in Europe, so European law applies. That's how we will, you know, kind of cordon off this. The French government saying, nope, that's not sufficient. We need this to apply for anyone anywhere in the world searching for a European citizen. And this is so basically an assertion that French law should govern the information that's accessible for anyone anywhere in the world, which is a big claim. It's a claim that we've like roundly rejected when, say, the government of Turkey says Turkish law preventing the defamation of Ataturk should apply across the board. And so we have Turkey not getting its law to apply globally has done things like block Twitter and YouTube and Facebook to say, you know, for information that those sites host that violates Turkish law. To have France making a similar claim and really digging in and saying, you know, like, nope, we're going to push this through our highest court, we're going to see just how far our jurisdiction can extend, is, you know, concerning enough in this particular case for Amberg to be forgotten. I think it would surprise a lot of people outside of Europe that the French government could be, you know, deciding what it is that they can access in terms of lawfully published information online. But sort of what this means for other governments making the same jurisdiction claim is an even bigger concern because it's like trying to figure out what is the justification to say, well, okay, fine, for France and their data protection laws, sure, but not for, you know, Thailand for its passionately held law against insulting the king of Thailand, right?
And following up on that, I know that this summer we've gotten a lot of sort of crazy people saying we don't need, like we don't want the internet to go into European hands, and I guess with that domain name.
Yeah, okay.
And so I'm wondering how you see that to be related, how you interpret the passion of those people, particularly since some of them also seem to support a candidate who talks about opening up libel laws.
there's a lot there. Right, so the IANA functions transition, right? So this is, you might have seen news articles over the, you know, the past, especially the past couple of months. Ted Cruz has been was a big kind of leader of the assertion that the Obama administration was giving away the internet to like the Chinese and the Russians, that it was, you know, handing over US control of the internet to foreign governments, terrible thing for free speech. And that was a really distorted report on what was actually happening. I won't get too bogged down, I can't set this back and bog down very quickly, but trying to the high level. So the naming system, how we access the internet, right, or how we access web pages, is overseen by this entity called the International Corporation for Sign Names and Numbers. It's incorporated in California. It's a multi-state body set up in the late 90s, basically to be as non-governmental as we could make it at the time, a way to manage the names and numbers of the internet, IP addresses and domain names, which is a single coordinated resource that does need to be coordinated in a but you coordinate it in a somewhat centralized fashion in IQ so that you don't have like multiple servers being assigned to the same IP address, you know, multiple people trying to host a website at the same domain name. the US government in Department of Commerce, NTIA, had a kind of a legacy oversight mechanism where they had a contract with ICANN for doing, for administration of what's called the IAM functions. These are, it was a, you know, a set of protocols and basically a set of administrative and clerical functions that are important to make sure that these kind of collisions and overlaps don't happen, but also aren't some kind of master key to the whole internet. Not really something that the US government had ever leveraged to control what was going on the internet, and not something that sort of the structure of ICANN could be used that way. But it was this last sort of vestige of US government direct involvement in part of the overall governance of the internet. The US government under the Obama administration a couple of years ago very wisely, I think, decided that, you know, this special relationship between the US government and these core internet governance functions had been a bone of contention, like, since the beginning, and it was getting increasingly heated in global discussions about how is the internet run and managed, and who has what responsibilities and who has what kind of power. There's a big push by some governments to move or create within, like, the United Nations system an intergovernmental regulatory body for the internet, right, where governments of the world agree to how the internet should be run, whatever that means. This is really concerning to a lot of folks, not only government, but particularly like the technical community, civil society, and industry, who have seen the internet grow up over the years in a not heavily top-down regulated government-controlled environment, and want to preserve what's called the multi-stakeholder model, the ability for different kinds of decisions about different pieces of the internet being made by different groups of people. So you've got a body like the Internet Engineering Task Force that is an open participatory body that defines the technical protocols that run, that the internet runs on. Everything from, you know, how do we encode real-time communications within a web browser, WebRTC, what are standards that we can use for encryption, all of the different kind of technical underpinnings developed in this body that is involves the participation of governments, but is not controlled or dictated by government in any way. So the IAM function is this point of, the US government's role in IAM functions has been this point of friction for many, many years. The US is like, let's get out of that, let's truly transition this over to even this piece of governance being run in a multi-stakeholder model. There's a really difficult process to figure out how to do that, right? Maybe you want, the nice thing about government is that it tends to have a system of accountability built in and defined. It might not be a great system, it might not be used well, or kind of used consistently fairly, but the idea of checks and balances and separation of power, you know, you've got, our constitution sets up accountability for government in pretty specific ways. How do you do that same kind of accountability for an entity that doesn't have that, you know, isn't governmental? And so, like, what does accountability look like there? So there's really, really long process that involved hundreds of hours of conference calls and working groups and incredible amounts of engagement from stakeholders all over the world to figure out what needs to change in the bylaws and governance of this body to ensure that it can be held accountable to the global community without any kind of tie to the government whatsoever. And that group of stakeholders came up with a proposal that was then supported and had consensus of everybody who was involved in the process. And this is what the US government was looking at and saying, yep, okay, you did what we asked you to, you came up with a system that would prevent this entity from being captured by government interests or corporate interests or, I guess, civil society interests. We don't tend to capture things very well, but there's accountability mechanisms in place, there's more work to be done to make sure that those are developed well and implemented well, but basically it was it was really amazing to watch, I mean, one, just how difficult it is to get such a complex question answered by such a sprawling process, but they did. They came up with something that's, you know, most people are looking at and saying, okay, this seems like it'll work if we all continue to try our hardest. And so that's what the Department of Commerce looked at and said at the end of last month, yep, the multi-stakeholder community did what we asked them to, we're not going to renew this contract. And so the US government relationship ended. Not without a last-ditch effort by some people who opposed the transition to get to state general lawsuit to try to block the transition at like almost literally in the 11th hour. It was the Friday the contract expiring that at 1 p.m. that the court was like, nope, okay, there's no point here. This doesn't go ahead. But it was just, so that's a problem. I don't know if I stay high level very well, but that's what was really going on there. And it was just fascinating to watch this really arcane part of internet governance that even people who understand it and work on it get bored of talking about pretty quickly. To see that kind of process get pulled up to like national political jockeying and, you know, trying to be used in the election and in Congress and taken up as sort of in its most abstract form a political rallying cry was really, really interesting and deeply frustrating for people who were involved in the process and really thinking hard about this and also understanding geopolitically what this meant. The whole point of this process was to make sure that no other government could claim that the US government had a special role or could, you know, assert control over the internet if they wanted to. And so for parts of our members of our government to at the last minute do their best to control the internet, it's like really the opposite of the point. But fortunately they did not succeed, and so it's not like this magically solves the question of will authoritarian governments want to move governments of the internet to a more authoritarian model. Of course they will keep trying to do that. But we have genuinely removed one vestige of a special relationship with the US government in this particular governance function. And that is, I think, a positive move. And it was pretty impressive to see the Obama administration, Larry Strickland and NTIA kind of commit to doing this a few years ago and through a very, very difficult process really see it through and really kind of live up to that commitment of, nope, we talk a lot about supporting a multi-stakeholder model and by then we're actually going to support it. Does that kind of answer?
That was fantastic.
So does that mean that .gov will become refer now to the British government too?
No, I think there are some. There were definite. That was probably in some list of kind of criteria. But the .gov and .mil will continue to be donors with the U.S. government, and that kind of shows how, you know, the U.S. government doesn't need to have any particular control over the domain name system to be able to have, you know, contracts that assure that particular domains are ones that they get to use and no other government gets to use.
Yeah. So what does Britain use?
I'm saying like .co.uk. So the kind of, there's country code and top level domains that each country has with some outliers debating of does a place count as country or not. But like every country has their own top level domain like .fr for France, or .ca for Canada. And so then my sense is that most governments do have basically a subdomain on that domain. So I think for Canada it's like gov.ca. And so then it's just a kind of a series of, because you can put a lot of stuff kind of before the very end domain. And so they just build kind of on that.
And the US has a top level.
Yeah,
that's one of those things. My site actually. It's cheaper than .com. So, a question that came up from the morality stuff we were saying earlier about the search results was it seems like data takes a lot of forms, it's transformed frequently once it changes hands. And it's a little hard to understand how you're going to enforce for a search engine to eradicate results or a piece of data when that data may have been through part of training an algorithm or classifying things or maybe part of statistics that are captured that are histograms or counts of things.
Yeah.
And even where these kind of statistics may allow you to re-identify the data from its original form. So doesn't that sort of make this whole this debate sort of a little empty, sort of saying, data as it's originally, that there can't be any record of that guy's foreclosure that's in a statistic. You know?
Yeah, no, well, I mean, it's a really good question, and it, it definitely comes up when you're looking at, what are different legislative approaches to right to be forgotten that we've seen come up. So there's a proposal in the law in California, it's called the eraser button for children or for minors. People under the age of 18 were given the utility in California to tell the operator some service that's collected data about them to stop processing that data. But in the debates around what was that law and how should it apply, exactly these questions came up. Because there's ways that legislators go to try to write right to be forgotten laws very broadly that says, the entity has to stop any use of that data and ensure that nobody else is processing that data either. And if you think about, I'm a credit card company and I have your address and I've also sold it to these other marketers, if you tell me I'm canceling my card, get rid of my address, I also have to tell these other marketers about it. You can kind of understand a version of, oh yes, this person has shared my data with these other people and I want to try to pull it back from all of them, conceptually. But when you're talking legally, I don't know if that makes sense. Right, but at least conceptually, you can kind of understand cases where the first person you share data with will still have a kind of a continuing relationship with that data as they've given it to others. But if you're talking about the first entity you give data with, give data to, publishes it to the world, the genie's out of the bottle, right? Like, you can't tag somebody to come up with a way to, actively tag and track that data, metaphorically, as it goes throughout the world. But the idea that you could tell Facebook, I posted this to Facebook, now I'm going to take it down, but I also want to make sure that the screenshot of that post that somebody took and is now tweeting about, that comes out too. And putting the burden on Facebook to say, you got to make sure that comes back.
The hand-drawn note.
Yeah, or even I took my phone to take a photo of this screen and now I've printed that in the newspaper, right? I mean, there's so many ways that data can be, kind of, when it's been published, absorbed in some way by other entities that the first processor that you gave that data to will have no knowledge about. And so a legal obligation on them to try to change all other uses of that data really falls apart. But then there's also the question, kind of the more technical question, of how should a demand that processors stop using my data apply to things like caching? If I say delete it from your servers, does that mean also delete it from all of their caches in a certain amount of time? What about backups? What about historical archives? And what about if I write a review on Amazon and I write some text and I also give something a two-star review and I write a really scathing review of this pair of jeans and then later I think better of it and I don't want to have that review up there anymore, I take it, I delete the review. Is Amazon also required to disaggregate my contribution of 2 stars to their overall rating for the product? Maybe they do that automatically because they're just constantly dynamically updating. Maybe they don't. Should the law be able to dictate how they do a kind of aggregate, make use of aggregate data when it has been dissociated from my identity, let alone that the risk of re-identification data can be distance ourselves from our data?
Right.
Yeah. Just a shorter trail off.
Wisely done.
Interesting.
I mean, I guess another wrinkle on this topic, and there was other ones we don't talk about, but was I was thinking about Showdown, which is, I guess, used by some security researchers to find but one of the things they use it for is searching for devices that are Internet of Things devices that are poorly secured. So like a recent giant botnet attack was facilitated by Showdown. Is that the kind of case where you'd say, oh, even just linking to that data, that should have some, should be significant legal? Because I was thinking when you were saying, just to link to data that's true and correct, and it's out there in the public, you might say, well, this is pointing to, I don't know, vulnerability. It's true, it's really there, but it's also directly actionable and could cause harm to the person who possesses
that vulnerability. So then should it be illegal to point people to information about this tool that exists that could be used for nefarious purpose?
Yeah, or for Showdown themselves to link to this, let's say this camera that you're using for your kid,
Right. Well, this gets into, there's a whole kind of debate right now, James doing, about the security research, right? And I would say, of course we should be able to talk about this vulnerability that exists. It's important to get that information out there. It's important to have access to what is that program that can do these sorts of things, because how else are we going to figure out how it works and how to guard against it and how to repair the vulnerabilities that this has determined. So it's not actually my area of research very much, but do you have thoughts to share kind of that whole, the question about access to information about security vulnerabilities?
Yeah, so white hat and gray hat hackers run into this very problem a lot where even by discovering a vulnerability, they are at great risk and probably are violating federal law, federal anti-hacking law. And so I think your comment has sort of two components. One is just figuring out the vulnerability in the first place, which has criminal implications, but maybe, so there's a set of cases, there's a litigation now challenging that and suggesting that there might be a First Amendment interest, not just to talk about things, but even to discover things, because that's what's required to later talk about it. So that's an interesting area that I'm working on right now. But then also, I think you were suggesting that the other problem is that once you've discovered the vulnerability, if you identify it, then does that set up imminent risk to the device that is sort of comparable to something like incitement or something? I'm thinking about old cases involving, like, okay, if I tell you how to build a hydrogen bomb, should that be treated almost like a threat in itself? So those are both live and
malware is the equivalent of fighting words or something.
Fighting words, yeah, that's right, yeah. So these are really, like, I think there's some hard areas of constitutional law.
So I have a question. So in terms of like a terrorist organization like ISIS, for example, right? I guess two things. In terms of like the Free Expression Project, how do you go about monitoring like an organization like that on the internet? And then two, like if one of us was like to click on their website, you know, like does that index, like does the index that function to us? So like they would know like this is the person who clicked on it, like they kind of have our, I'm serious, that's kind of, I'm kind of
no,
scared.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
that's
no.
Actually, like, I was like, I clicked on it by accident, I'm like, oh my God, I got it, it's scary.
Right, well, I mean, and the it's a great example of how, of course, we can't assume that every person who searches, you know, information about ISIS online is a terrorist, right? There's all sorts of reasonable reasons for wanting to find out more information about a group that is driving foreign policy for much of the world right now. So, yeah, the ISIS has been a complicating factor for a lot of the policy around free speech and privacy online, especially over the past couple of years. There was actually a proposal by Senator Feinstein in Congress, 8 months to a year ago, that would require, it was going to create what appeared to be federal criminal requirement for all providers of internet services and telecommunication services to report to the federal government when they became aware of apparent terrorist activity on their networks. Apparent terrorist activity was not defined, which is one of many, many problems with this bill. let alone the specter having US law that says, yes, all of our companies must inform on all of their users to the government, sort of no questions asked. It was not great for a number of reasons, but part of the question, very question was like, what is a company supposed to consider evidence of terrorist activity? I would want that defined, I would want them to have some information in the first place, but I would want that defined incredibly narrowly. Like if you have hard evidence that somebody is involved in an imminent commission of a crime, that's one thing. If you have what appears to be a pattern of people looking up information about a terrorist group, that could apply to reporters, advocates, activists, just concerned citizens who want to understand more about what's going on. It could apply to people who, in their hearts and minds, support what ISIS is saying and have no plans whatsoever to commit violence. And that's something that we have to keep in mind when we're talking about terrorist propaganda online. It is, of course, legitimate for government to prevent commission of violent acts, commission of crimes, commission of terrorist acts. But under international human rights law, we have not just freedom of expression, but also freedom of opinion, and the freedom to hold opinions. And that freedom, unlike freedom of expression, freedom of opinion cannot be limited by the government. There's no kind of incursion into that is acceptable. And so in freedom of expression, we have, there's a framework very similar to the First Amendment framework of, under compelling circumstance, for compelling interests, and in a narrowly tailored and least restrictive means sort of way, government may put some limits on free expression, not on freedom of opinion. So if you're sitting there holding a very extreme opinion, and even an opinion that's like, it's legitimate to pursue violent ends to advance your cause, and you're not committing any crimes, you're not actually, threatening violence, but that's also your right. I mean, so the rights that we have in terms of accessing information and holding opinions are broad and strong, and they should be. But a lot of what we're seeing in all of the policy efforts around extremist content is we've got to stop people from being radicalized, because radicalization leads to, going off to Syria to fight or committing violent acts at home. And so it's this, from my view, very pernicious kind of creeping back the chain of events from, commission of a violent act to what is it that gets people on the road to starting to think about maybe committing a violent act. And so there's been a lot of focus around both what is the obligation of tech companies to try to take down as much content that is in favor of ISIS or other extremist groups as they can. There's also, some focus on the idea of counter speech. And that's very prevalent in the First Amendment tradition, the idea of, what do you do if there's bad speech? The answer is more speech. It's not to censor, it's to promote alternative ideas or views, to either counter the speech directly, to engage with it and discuss why it's wrong, or just to demonstrate that there's other ways of thinking or other views or other information out there. And there's, been some focus, including by the US government, on more the counter speech method than the censorship method. But there's a lot of pressure, particularly from European governments, about on companies to do more to take down, whether it's, pushing Twitter until they can come out with a statement that, yes, we've taken down 125,000 accounts related to ISIS, or pushing Facebook and YouTube to have, to really enforce their policies against speech that promotes terrorist activities or ideology, and actually setting up there's some programs in Europe that are focused on governments using companies' terms of service enforcement policies rather than kind of traditional legal routes to prosecute speech as a way to get content taken down. So law enforcement officer flags a video on YouTube rather than bringing a court case saying this video violates the laws of the United Kingdom, say. To me, that's really dangerous because companies restrict more in their terms of service than what government can restrict under law. And so if we then have governments using the standards of what the company set and not the standards of what law set, you've got governments pursuing speech that might actually be lawful.
Do you think that would be classified as state action?
I do. I'm more familiar with and confident of the analysis under First Amendment law than under human rights law. I think that would be the key thing to establish, right? But basically, you're kind of boiling down to if it's a government program that, you know, formal effort of the government with the aim to see content removed, see speech taken out of public sphere, then to me that's state action. The question comes up, I think, that because the ultimate decision maker in taking down the speech is the individual company, right? Like, they're looking at, does this video, does this post violate our terms of service? And so there's the argument that, well, it's private decision making and sort of the government involvement makes no difference. I think if government is coming up with a kind of a policy against certain, you know, seeing certain speech available on public websites, you know, particularly if they're going after speech across multiple websites, and particularly if they're targeting speech that, you know, if it was happening in the U.S. and they're going after, government's going after hate speech, right? Government couldn't prosecute that under the laws. We don't have laws against hate speech. So, you know, that would be, to me, the kind of the easiest case of, like, you're using taxpayer money to pursue speech that you couldn't go after under the law in a way that provides none of the procedural protections that we have in First Amendment tradition to... Yes, government's doing something wrong there, and I would hope that we could get a court to agree. So there's a lot of print activity around that.
I know it's about 1 o'clock. We wanted to save a few minutes for everyone to mingle with Emma if they wanted to. But I have one more thing to say about this ISIS issue, which is I've noticed too some of the. I don't know if you're aware where you know you. Someone were to look for ISIS and almost, you know, how do I sign up? And then it would intercept and come with a different message for me to help me join a support group for people that thought they wanted to join ISIS instead. So there, you know, can you just say briefly what, how are they doing that? And how do they decide who's going to get the message for
so
people
really
that need to be recovering?
Yeah, the kind of research arm of Google, which is called Jigsaw, but used to be called Google Ideas, actually just had a study come out about, or a report come out about a study that they were conducting, and it was great that they actually put this report out and like provided some transparency in here, because we know that companies are experimenting with stuff all the time, but they just like don't tell us about it. So they ran a study that looked at not changing search results directly, not the kind of the core search product. Google tends to be very protective of, you know, what is it that they're doing in that set of search results and trying not to implement like outsider policy in it. That's really a reflection of Google's own algorithmic secret sauce. But then they also, alongside search results, serve ads. And ads obviously are, there's different incentives for what shows up in ads than what shows up in search. With search, at least, the relationship with the company to the user is they really are trying to connect the user with information that is relevant to that user. And so serving them the opposite of that in that part of the page would be really counterintuitive to what they're trying to do. But ads, you know, the incentive there is some third party, some advertiser wants to get in front of you too, and they paid us to enable that. So they experimented in the ads that they were showing alongside search results, and what they were doing was showing ads for basically like as ads links to different YouTube playlists that a couple of consulting companies had created for kind of a bunch of different kinds of arguments that might be persuasive to somebody who's sympathetic to ISIS ideology, whether it's kind of legal and doctrinal interpretation of Islamic law and beliefs, or is it talking more specifically about kind of the violence that ISIS has committed, or kind of the economic status? And so identifying sets of search queries that they thought that were more kind of specific than how to join ISIS, but were about like if somebody's searching for the name of the building that is known to be a recruitment center, you know, the border of Turkey, that's maybe an indication that they know a lot about what it takes to join ISIS, and so might be a particularly you know, useful, or particularly relevant person to try to target with countervailing information. And what they found was that creating these playlists of different video, and they didn't create any original content, this was all material that had already been uploaded to YouTube, that they sort of found and said, okay, these are credible voices offering this alternative opinion. And they did find, they ran kind of tests of random YouTube playlists and these targeted playlists, and did find a statistically significant rate of people engaging with those ideas, that you could kind of, if you put the right sort of kind of message, you know, they're looking for something really about the core of ISIS belief system, and you put videos or links to videos that are a very thoughtful scholar describing the alternate, that they had some success with getting engagement of those people clicking through, watching the videos for a while, kind of, you know, being exposed to this alternate viewpoint. Whether that leads to people changing their views, it's really hard. So one thing I liked about the study was that it was very kind of constrained to what is the thing that they could actually study through that, and not making sweeping claims about this prevents radicalization, right? This changes hearts and minds, or prevented it from happening or something. Because that is a claim that we have yet to figure out how to test, right? And would require really invasive tracking and monitoring of people. So there is some very thoughtful experimentation around what would promoting counter views actually look like. So I was really glad to see that Jigsaw was also being open about this kind of study and what they were looking at, and had clear, you know, statements and commitments that they were not tracking any of the users who were involved in this, right? Like, if they do that, then they've got a list that I imagine many governments would want to see. So a really kind of fraught area, but there's some really interesting research going on.
Yeah. Thank you. I want to be mindful of people's time, and thank you so much for making thank you, David, for moderating today. Feel free to mingle and talk with Emma.
experiment that you do.
Okay.
And so the idea is when you perceive the privacy to be greater, you're more likely to comply with what the procedure says to do. So if it says to lie, you will lie.
Okay.
Even if you're asked a question that you normally don't want to answer truthfully and directly.
And so in the other scenario where, sort of through statistical models, but they also are answering some awkward questions very honestly, they actually comply. Even if you've given the assurances of statistical privacy, they still want to take that extra step. Like, I can obfuscate real information myself. So.